fight. Preacher man, oh, tell me, heaven is on the deer. I know you don't know what life is really worth. It's an art that Peter is gold. After story had never been told. So now you see the light, hey, stand up for your right. Come on,
get up.
For eyes to see and ears to hear, never has it been so clear that the world is against us. Biblically, the Christian persecution precedes being taken up in the clouds. Are you prepared? The Donald said there was a storm ahead. Do you really believe that he was speaking about the weather, or was it Masonic doublespeak? Or was it rather dually intended and hermetically clever, like the lyrics in this song?
Most people think great God will come from the sky, take away everything and make everybody feel high. But if you know what life is worth, you would look for yours on earth. And now you see the light, you stand up for your rights. Yeah.
Get up.
And who was the W speaking of when he said that an angel guides this whirlwind along? And do you realize that those who taught you that this was a Christian-run nation were dead wrong?
Yeah. You're sick and tired of your ism, schism, game, dine and go to heaven in a Jesus' name, Lord. We know and we understand Almighty God is a living man. You can fool some people sometimes, but you can't.
Now, prayer is not welcome in school, or not welcome just about anywhere, regardless of how you feel about it. Don't folks have the right to do it if they'd like? And dying and going to heaven at all has not been the concern of a generation that's been turned toward the brightness of the false light. A generation seeking after a sign, wicked and adulterous and blind as the man in John chapter 9. The FBI and alphabet agencies keep files on their operatives too. Compromised men who gain power and popularity would go rogue if left unwatched. He too was used to spread the doctrine of devils via Aleister Crowley's Do As Thou Wilt, Jamaican style. If there were ever any real files on Marley, it was to keep close watch and ensure that he did not grow weary or become contrite and reveal the secret of the Brotherhood, the serpent's seed. The true rulers of ancient Atlantis, inhabitants of the deep. There is an angel guiding this whirlwind too. The new.
the big idea. Don't stay in there talking, son. Speak up.
Suffering from a major psychological disorder, and that it might actually be bipolar. It could be that. The doc then predicts how much longer they'll live. Sick, I know, but I also know you want to hear what she has to say. The doc says if these people don't get help, it's written up fast. I haven't read any of this. Brittany won't make it to the age 30, Lindsay won't be 25, and Michael Jackson has no more than 5 years left. At the other end, Angelina's going to have a long, healthy life, and so will George Bush and the Clinton.
If you're not already bipolar,
if you're yelling in the booth, are they yelling at me for the way I read that?
Or did great.
Okay.
But Whitney, if you're not,
excuse me.
I could hear Lisa yelling.
Give her a break. She didn't boot it earlier. She doesn't know the story. It's okay. Stop it. She's okay.
I could hear you. I heard you. Oh.
It may be that the reporters who display this anomaly are indeed or were once fully human, as this does indicate a form of possession. The shapeshifters are not extraterrestrial, but extra-dimensional and earthbound, and today we would know of as devils or demons.
Hey, I have a question for you, Lisa, since you mentioned your nose.
Yes.
Okay, so my husband and I have been obsessing because we both have the same kind of nose, and we've never had a nose job or anything, but we have the exact same, and in my womb, my baby girl has my nose.
Oh, yeah.
And so I was wondering about women who have nose jobs and say their husbands don't know, and then the baby pops out, and it's got the big schnoz, and he's like, where'd that come from?
I know, exactly. Well, that's when you start making a plastic surgery fund for your children when they're born.
Never too early, right?
Too soon to start. That and therapy, because I think we've got that going for Ben and Elsie. Oh, look back at these cute faces. Anyway, you guys,
hey, listen.
Probably the most clear and consistent examples come from CNN, Atlanta-based CNN, Atlantis, and Brian Todd. As the public becomes more aware of their presence, YT scrubbers remove the best footage and turn videos from digital to analog quality. The windows to the soul are truly the eyes. Also, the stories they cover seem to be in line with the One World agenda. News broadcasts utilize many forms of deception, wizardry, and deflection to put the viewer in a state of semi-hypnosis to aid in cloaking their true form.
An option, placing a tracking microchip under a service member's skin. Former U.S. Special Operations officers tell us they believe that's being developed. Current military officials won't comment on that, Wolf.
Yeah, what about the cost, Brian? Is that at all a consideration?
It's a big consideration. Just about every former officer I spoke with says the cost of outfitting each combat troop with a tracking device, is one of the main reasons they don't have them right now.
So when you speak with the various Special Operations...
Combat troop with a tracking device is one of the main reasons they don't have the device.
Operations types and others, and I know you've been doing a lot of reporting on this, the pros and cons of having these kinds of tracking devices. What do they say, Brian?
Some believe that every service member should have them. Some should have them. Some don't because of the risks we talk about, but others say if they can deal with the cost and pay for all of this, it is worth it not only to track missing troops, but to be able to tell friendlies from enemies on the battlefield.
Brian Todd reporting for us. Such devices, by the way, are
cost and pay for all of this. It is worth it not only to track missing troops, but to be able to tell friendlies from enemies on the battlefield.
Brian Todd reporting for us. Such devices, by the way, are not... tools for war. They're also tools that could keep all of us and all of our families safe. We saw that back in February when three mountain climbers and their dog were stranded overnight on Oregon's Mount Hood. Rescuers found them all safe by tracking their mountain locator unit, a device similar to the one seen here. Also, many models of cell phones use GPS tracking software that could locate you in case of an emergency. There are also several products available to keep track of children. Many of them act as emergency cell phones and tracking devices, with some even able to display on a map the places your child has visited.
Now you give him everything you want, you understand? Okay.
And more modern MKUltra techniques include the occult practice of tethering or tying spirits, devils, demons, to alter personalities of victims. MKUltra victims invariably describe experiences with these entities, and along with reporters, entertainers, politicians, and stars have become their vessels of choice.
Recently, I did a video of Alex Jones having a facial meltdown. It looked like he was having a hard time holding himself together. In the course of that video, I showed a clip from this 1977 backstage. I guess it was a little bit of a ceremony for Elvis.
This was Rapid City, South Dakota. Here you see Elvis being presented with a plaque.
And the Medallion of Life from a little girl.
Her name is easy to find online, but I didn't want to put it out here on this video. It's a little bit weird to have your name associated with this. And she is still alive. And let me just say right up front, I do not believe she is a shapeshifter. Now, let's get into the weirdness. Elvis is about to accept the Medallion of Life from the little girl. He's going to lean in, give her a kiss. Everything seems pretty normal up until this point. You'll see some pictures here in a moment, but then about here, things get a little strange. So now we're going to go through a series of pictures where you see the little girl have a range of emotions. And then right about here, she sees something wrong as he pulls away. What does she see? Well, we're all about to see it for ourselves as he stands up and looks at the camera right here. What's weird is somehow the guy holding the microphone misses this part. But here, very soon, he's going to notice something that is amiss. I think that'll be right about here. And he looks a little disturbed. After seeing this, he quickly walks away and then acts like nothing ever happened. Look at his face. Yikes. You also see a couple of Elvis's men seeing everything as it happens. One of them steps in front of the camera. The other man goes directly for the eye that was just melting. Here we go again in real time. See Elvis's guy step in front of the camera right here. Then the other guy goes right for the eye. He saw exactly what happened. That's the only way to explain him going right onto the eye. Now you start to see some other weirdness around Elvis's face. Looks like he's getting holes around his eyes. Now, people will tell you, no, those were just dark circles under his eyes. You know, have you ever seen this phenomenon before? And also, look at the shape of his face and head. He looks like a turtle, if not a snake, right there. Now, that's important because this is the afternoon of the concert, just a few hours before he goes on stage. We're going to see him on stage here in a little bit, and he's going to look very, very different. In fact, now, is this the same guy we just saw? In this next picture coming up, was supposed to be taken at the same time as the other picture. What is going on here? How does this even make sense? Now, as they're leaving, if you look back in the background, you'll see them working on Elvis, which he's going to need a lot of work to look like he did in the one picture, that's for sure. One more time, let's look again. I don't even believe that's the same guy. I just don't see it. He looks entirely different. All the way around. It's supposed to be the same day, the same night, the same moment. Even the little girl looks different. Now, here's an article about those videotapes. You see the blurry part right in the middle is because this gentleman could not sell these tapes for profit. Someone got a hold of them years ago. I saw this online, and they put the entire 4.5 hours online. Now, someone has chased it all down, but that's where I first came in contact with this weird video, the one where his face blows up. The thing about the black and white videos is they're from a pure source. They were only handled by that one gentleman for years and years. So they have more of a clean line of ownership. Now, I don't know what happened to put this online or if he had anything to do with it, but someone snuck them out years and years ago and put the whole 4.5 hours on. I watched it. I didn't record it, but I remember seeing this initial video where his head explodes, and I just didn't know what to make of it. And then I went back and it was gone. It disappeared. And now look how much better the quality is of this video suddenly from the one we had seen earlier. There are cleaner and cleaner versions of this floating around, and there is a version of this where none of this happens. Yeah, bothersome. But there, right there in the color, it was still visible. I've had a lot of time since the first time I saw this video to come up with crazy reasons that maybe his face did do this, but it wasn't anything unusual. Maybe he had a mini stroke. Maybe it was a medical condition of some sort. I don't know, but what kind of medication did they give him that made his face structurally that different in that short a period of time? I don't know. And what was the deal with the guy going right for his eye after it looked like it blew out of his head? Like the dude saw it. Also, one other thing while I'm thinking about it, I'm not going to rewind this tape yet again, but before his guy steps in front of the camera, he has his back to the camera and Elvis is talking to him. And then after he blocks the camera shot for a second and Elvis talks to him, the guy turns back around and it's obvious he's looking to see the camera position, but he's acting like he's looking at something else. I don't know. I would love there to be some easy answers here because this is infinitely bothersome to me. Right down to the fact that some people seem to notice this transformation, then others don't. And as you continue to look at this at different moments, he's equally, like, horrendously hideous in each video, but at different times. And I think I'm about to call it a day. I just saw something once again I've never noticed before in the black and white film. I don't know, you spend too long with something like this, it begins to get in your head. My suggestion, whenever you're bored, go find this, screen record it, because it will be gone again, and then go frame by frame yourself. I don't know. Maybe this explains why Elvis was never wanting to go out in public. Now, I never could get a time frame here. You see him being worked on, and then you see him coming out, and there's another example of two pictures taken at the same time with the same people. Was it really? Or do you think the one on the left was maybe a makeup or mock-up later on? At the end of this video, I'll show you one more thing where Google's gotten involved in trying to cover this up a little bit that's also bothersome. But for now, we'll go back to the door and Elvis coming out to sing at his final live concert in front of a crowd. Here he is. Now, he looks much better here too, doesn't he? Same show. This is South Dakota. He played on the 19th. He played on the 21st. The 21st was South Dakota. There he is. Look at him. Is that the same guy from a while ago that looked like a turtle? And what is up with that? I don't know. All I know is this. There was a bunch of weirdness going around Elvis right there at the end. That's really all I have in that regard. And here he is on stage once again, looking like a completely different guy than the dude whose eye had just blown out and he was starting to turn into a turtle. Yeah, he's a little jowly here. Got some jowls going, but very different. Allegedly on drugs or not, I don't care. I ain't never seen no drugs that could do that to a person. Last thing before we go, this is how Google presents that day. If you go through a lot of their stuff, now granted you will be able to find the video you just saw here, but Google doesn't really go out of their way for you to see it. After all, wouldn't want to disturb anyone. Thanks for watching, guys. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And as always, stay vigilant.
The real gods of the Brotherhood are the serpent seed. They need you to believe that they come from space so that you don't believe that the scripture told the truth about them, too. Fathers of the lies, fathers of New Age, and of the Queen Mother Goddess's true form. We're not talking about David Icke, although he is the person that most folks credit with coming up with the theory of how the reptilian agenda works worldwide. He is certainly not the first person to ever discover the existence of beings who claim to be from the stars. They told ancient man that they were from the stars. In fact, they are from right here on Earth, and they have learned to cloak themselves and live among us. Now, it's interesting because this is yet another thing, a hard-to-believe thing, like the Earth being flat, that the Bible has already told us. In the beginning, in Genesis, it talks about the seed of Eve being at odds with the serpent's seed. And although that's been eschatologically divided and dissected a bunch of different ways, what the new information is leading us to, and that's relatively new to most of us. It may be new to some of you, but this information has come out by way of the internet and the web that has a lot of folks overstanding what is meant in that particular passage of Genesis. There are two sides. You are either of one seed or the other. And much like we saw in the film They Live, the Brotherhood elite are not comprised of merely men who are of this particular seed and women, but also comprised of puppets and lackeys, pawns that are human, like you and I. This was foretold in the scripture. We don't have to have Donald Marshall tell us, who has some credible things in his story. And if you look at his later works, they obviously got a hold to him and made him an offer that he should have refused. Then you have Credo Mutua, who was brought to us by David Icke. Credo Mutua has admittedly said that he's a homosexual. And if you watched his first interviews with Icke, it was obvious that he was a part of this human group of pawns. As he said, part of his initiation to have access to the information that the reptilians, as they're called, provided the Zulu nation, or the shaman, the high priest class of the Zulu nation. That information could only come to those who had been initiated, and he was initiated through the eating of flesh. Yet another person brought to us by Icky Ike was old Arizona Wilder, who she has some things in her story that we know to be true, but there's also some more dubious things. One reason is because once people have become targeted and have these experiences, they are usually under a strong delusion through both the combined efforts of the Brotherhood members creating a false reality around them. They begin to lose their faith. You see Credo Mutua moving toward the same civilization, according to the ankh around his neck, as we know was under this reptilian control by the wajat that was worn on the pharaoh's headdress. And oftentimes these individuals have been severely traumatized. Donald Marshall, I believe in the beginning, was telling a story that he knew to be true, but it was laced, like all things that the Brotherhood disseminate and then allow for their targets or pawns or operatives to distribute to us. His information was tainted, and it was full of anti-Christ propaganda. Because at the end of the day, these beings have from the very beginning been set against Christ in their attempts to deride him include feeding mankind stories about their origin, about the origin of man and the origin of these beings, that they would believe, and especially in latter times when knowledge has increased, that they would prefer, opposed to the words of the scripture that point to a particular people who are still lost in the sauce when it comes to the mystery of their history. David Icke has been caught, quote unquote, shifting. And we don't know what word to use to actually describe the phenomenon that's been captured in many different reporters from just about every news station. But I do find it ironic that in the movie They Live, the final scenes where Roddy Piper and Keith David are attempting to stop this reptilian elite take place at a television news station. If you were part of an agenda to distribute information that would enslave the masses, you would certainly want to take control of the news. What I'd like to do, and I do believe it's time for the scroll to unfold, is to rightly divide this thing without the misinformation that we get from men who don't believe themselves, and therefore they don't have the discernment that the Holy Spirit would provide so that they can rightly tell us what's going on. And I just pray that you receive this information and that it helps you to overstand the Atlantean Aquarian agenda and what it's really all about at the end of the day. So this will be a multi-part series. They're found all throughout scripture. If you have eyes to see and the will to look, they're found in the beginning, especially, and in the end, especially, of the book. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And they've been laying low the entire time, waiting for the perfect moment to reveal themselves once mankind had become godless and self-centered enough to believe the lie that they were created by alien beings. This took a lot of science fiction. It took a lot of exaltation of false history and alternative facts. And it took a lot of degradation of society by way of the Brotherhood, who worked behind the scenes to create programming that would ready us for the day that they knew would come. They're not from outer space, but the fallen ones who were cursed with a curse because of their lowly and cunning and subtle and deceptive behavior. They were given the body form of a lower being that crawled upon its belly but had similar attributes. This is the fitting way that our Father chose to deal with them. They are able to not necessarily shapeshift into anything, but do have the ability to become the things that tempt mankind. They can become a mother or queen. In the beginning, the temple whores or the priestess whores of ancient Babylon. The image of Semiramis or Ishtar or Ashtar. Semiramis is said to have come down to earth in a space egg. These beings gave an entire history to the Sumerians, according to the Sumerians themselves, about them coming here on a mothership, Nibiru. But there's a firmament they can't get through. Folks who are jazzed up about disclosure are also used as pawns in this grand chess game. And of course, the lights that people see in the sky, lights I've seen myself, things that you know aren't falling stars, things moving vertically, things moving horizontally across the sky, you know that there's something up there, and they're going to remain hidden until the right time that they can introduce themselves, not in their true forms, like in Childhood's End, but in a deceptive costume, more like the television series V. The Bible makes a clear difference between serpents, snakes, and dragons. Serpents and dragons are used to describe these beings and beings that they created through genetic manipulation that is also told of in extra-biblical texts, or what we call extra-biblical texts, such as the Book of Yasher and the Book of Enoch, which of course critics disagree upon the authenticity of, and of course they would if the Brotherhood has anything to do with it. Their intention, even in the story of Semiramis, was to make it believed by man that they had come down from the stars. This ancient deception would also be the part of a latter-day plan that they would need to enact after mankind as a whole had built up the civilization with the Brotherhood behind the scenes and was made ready through the Brotherhood's propagandas, through pop culture, to receive these beings as their gods and creators. We are now at that time. And of course, the United Nations created State of Israel is ready to throw their hat into the ring and get into the act. The 15-minute landing sequence of the Israeli moon lander, Bereshit, which means in the beginning, from Genesis, will be crucial for measuring the lunar magnetic field, we are told. Perhaps they'll share with NASA how they supposedly got through the so-called Van Allen belt. Unfortunately, a lot of times when a person wants to learn a new language, the first words that they will be turned on to are curse words. It appears that they've given us a bunch of bad words and told us they are Hebrew to describe our scripture. Who is giving us these words, you say? The Russians, who once inhabited the Caucasus Mountains and say they are Jews, but are not. Revelations 20 and 8. And shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And unfortunately, all that survives are the languages that they learned while they were in captivity, and they've passed them on to you and me as we attempt to try to learn a language that's been lost for thousands of years. And that was to God's design. European-born Khazars, Ashkenazis, mostly from Russia, truly feeding you some better sheet. from a place where bears were more plentiful than dogs and considered to be almost innumerable from the beginning, their beginning. It is not right to give the children's meat unto the dogs, or to return to your vomit like one. Who would equate the beginning of creation with dog feces? Trump may praise his brotherhood buddy Putin, but the truth is, siding with Israel will bring inevitable war with Iran. And war with Iran will inevitably and biblically lead to war with Russia. Albert Pike, who was a captain for the U.S. Army during the American Civil War, was also a prominent yet controversial high-ranking Freemason. In a letter dated August 15, 1871, addressed to his Italian friend, politician Giuseppe Mazzini, who put the M in Mafia, who was also a Freemason, Pike described three events that were seen as necessary to bring about the One World Order. Pike's prophecy, quote-unquote, was based on a vision he said he had received.
Now spread out. And you old crip bastard.
Ironically, historians and authorities agree. It should be stated right from the start that Pike's Three World Wars letter is a controversial topic, as are reptilians, and there are serious doubts about its authenticity, quote unquote. Some state it never existed, others think it's fake, and there are naturally those who consider it to be genuine. The prophecy letter was mentioned in William Guy Carr's book entitled Pawns in the Game, which was published in 1958. The Brotherhood's bloodline family, the Bushes, was very concerned with Iraq, both the father and the son. It was generational, bloodline. Iraq, today, was Babylon in the time of the scripture. It is no coincidence that Iraq and other parts of the so-called Middle East have been the stages for the war, and the theater of war continues there and has done so now for over two decades. This is to complete the great work all over the world, even among people who have been made resistant through their misguided dedication to Islam, a true religion of the crescent moon goddess. But we'll talk about that in other parts, where they worship the cube, another symbol of Saturn or the urn of Set, which is symbolic for Satan.
Just a moment ago, it's gone.
He was so decrepit.
Stanley Kubrick did get weary of the Brotherhood plan, and perhaps he did try to send us some messages in Eyes Wide Shut, for which he was killed, messages that helped to link the Brotherhood elite with child trafficking and sexual abuse of children, ritual sexual abuse. But he also did 2001, A Space Odyssey, which put him on the map, and also is the reason why many people believe that he was the director who helped NASA pull off one of the greatest hoaxes of mankind. Perhaps he knew Albert Pike's plan, and there's no coincidence that his movie 2001 had prominently featured within it images of this stone being worshipped by apes. And of course, this is still from the Brotherhood perspective, as they view the uninitiated as monkeys or apes, sheeple, who are from the perspective of Yiddish-speaking Brotherhood Kabbalists, Goyim. The United Nations in its infancy was tied to what we know as now the Lucius Trust, but was originally called the Lucifer Trust, which of course was headed by Blavatsky and Kabbalist Alice Bailey and her husband Foster Bailey. Bailey was a student of Blavatsky, and they both belonged to secret orders, and they took orders from who they called the Ascended Masters, nothing but these same beings in the disguise of light beings, transforming as ministers of light and bringing the world what we now call New Age. But we all should know better than to trust old Lion Lucius or any of his friends. Where'd you get your funk from? Hopefully not from her. She says, healing does not come through intense affirmation of divinity or by simply pouring out love and the expression of a vague mysticism. Alice Bailey. She says, it comes through mastering an exact science of contact. Contacting what? Impression. Of invocation, invoking what? Plus an understanding of the subtle apparatus of the etheric vehicle, and the serpent was more subtle than any of the other beasts of the field. Coincidentally and ironically, there is a meditation room inside of the United Nations, a worldwide governing body. What do they have to do with a religion and with the worship of this stone? It is the lithomancy of the builders, the ancient builders that we now know of as Freemasons, who claim to have built Solomon's temple. However, we know from the Testament of Solomon that Solomon's temple was built through the use of devils. How does this relate? The square men are taught the mystery of history in such a way as to lead them into Eastern religions by the time they've reached higher degrees, similarly to how when people go to the universities as believers, they come out as unbelievers, pagans, or New Agers. The popular form of meditation used today is all about clearing the mind and opening up one's self, whether it's called opening up your chakras, or opening up your third eye, or opening up your mind. They're opening you up like a vessel to pour inside of you these vile and disgusting spirits who will make you feel enlightened as they are able to transform into ministers of light. However, they will put you into a terrible plight by pushing you back into the bondage of the ways of Babylon and Egypt, which influenced the entire world, the ways of the ancient Vidians of India, the ways that were influenced by their hundreds of gods, which we now know were not gods at all, but these beings who went to every continent, including North America. These beings who also brought forth the giants of Genesis chapter 6, which have been discovered also all over the world. These beings went from nation to nation and from people to people and explained themselves as the gods of these people. They did many great signs and wonders, as they will do today, and they taught people to worship nature and the world around them, all in order to turn their attention away from the coming Christ and away from the established rules of the Most High that were inherent in man at one time. Now that those rules are no longer inherent in man, and man no longer has a desire to pay any attention to scripture or the things of the Bible, because he considers himself learned, it is a badge of honor to say that you have left the church and you have left the scripture and you are now into one of these old ancient religions which only lead to possession and are designed to do just that by the original designers, who are older and who do predate Christ's coming in the flesh to straighten it all out. That's why he came. In the scripture, we even find that the priest of Israel were looking for power and were deceived by these same clever deceptions that do indeed give one at least a sense of power for a time. Then the bait and switch happens, and that which gives you power, which is truly powered by you, begins to take power from you, and you are under its power. Apostle Paul is held in great disdain by Kabbalists because he described the way that a minister should be. And it is not the way of the modern rabbi, nor the Hebrew priests after they came out of captivity in Babylon and learned the Babylonian ways, picked up the Zohar and the Talmud and the Kabbalah, and all that survives today are remnants of these teachings and the words that come from them. They want you to believe that they are so great as to have preserved their stolen legacy and kept their history as a long-time tradition. That's falsehood, and it's only a way to make them appear more powerful and to give them credibility as the chosen. Also, to hide their secret and sacred affiliations with the Brotherhood, which have kept them in possession of ancient knowledge, going back to ancient Babylon, that teaches them magic and mysticism that they can use over the masses, or so-called Goyim. If you are triggered, go over there on your channel and make you a video, because if you ignore me, I will ignore you too. It's very obvious to see that we should not do as we are taught by the fake Revelation 2:9 crew. The king of the Jews, who true 2:9ers and 3:9ers of Revelations do not believe was the Messiah, who came in the flesh from Nazareth, he said, "Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? He came to free you from the bondage of wearing certain things, eating certain things, and doing certain traditions and practices mechanically in the guise of someone being holy. He demanded the circumcision of the heart, and he demanded that you walk his walk and follow his example, which does not require for you to learn another language. Please read what's written in the Gospels. Follow Christ, or else you're freestyling, and written always comes out better. Revelation chapter 2, verse 25, "But that which ye have already, hold fast till I come, thus saith the Lord, King and Savior." Play with fire if you want to. You have become wise in your own eyes if you believe that you can grasp ancient Eastern religions and meditation and crystallomancy and all of the other mancies without the effects that they're meant for. Those things are all created. Even the languages that came from out of Babylon, brought by the Hebrew priests to open you up to spirits that are conjured through the mantras and through the mudras that these fallen beings taught mankind in order to open up their third eyes and vibrate in such a way as to let these things in them. At first they told them that it was for power. They did this millennia ago, and they are doing the same thing today. They continually find artifacts to help to back up this story that Eastern religion is somehow the key to freedom. Eastern religion includes the religions of Islam and Hebraism. You cannot follow either one. You must follow the way of the Messiah, who came to set the crooked things straight and to make straight the path. So many have become deceived, especially in the information age. What's getting in formation? A new army is being formed, and it's the army of the seed of the serpent. Be wise as one, but gentle as a dove, lest you become unwillingly a part of that army. It's simple. While Israel pretends to be the homeland of the Jews, it is actually the homeland of the Orthodox Jews. Israel has a state religion, which is Orthodox Judaism. It maintains two chief rabbis, one Sephardic Orthodox, one Ashkenazi Orthodox. The so-called national education system is actually a light Orthodox education system. We have also a national Orthodox education system and several shades of ultra-Orthodox education systems. There was once a humanistic school system, but David Ben-Gurion dismantled it. They call it the Khazar hypothesis of Ashkenazi ancestry. A hypothesis indicates that it may not be true. It's someone's theory. However, we know it to be true. However, they have to hide this in order to be Jew. The Khazar hypothesis of Ashkenazi ancestry, often called the Khazar myth by its critics, is the hypothesis that Ashkenazi Jews are descended from the Khazars or Khazars, a multi-ethnic conglomerate of Turkish people, Turkic people, who formed a semi-nomadic khanate in the area extending from Eastern Europe to Central Asia. The hypothesis draws on some medieval sources, such as the Khazar correspondence, according to which at some point in the 8th and 9th centuries, the ruling elite of the Khazars was said by Judah Halevi and Abraham Ibn Daud to have converted to rabbinic Judaism. They are converted Jews from Eastern Europe, and they have no reason whatsoever to dish out information that will make that well known to you, nor to dish out information that will make you more able to identify with being Hebrew. But just the opposite is true. They were called one of the foremost trading empires of the medieval world, and it's interesting that the caricature used by George Lucas in the Star Wars films, where the representative of the banking clan sitting at the round table with Lord Grievous, certainly looks like a caricature of a Jewish man. And yes, he's from the banking clan. It is also interesting how easy it is for a European to masquerade as a Jew, or as someone who claims to be a Jew to masquerade as a non-Jew. George Lucas himself is supposed to be Jewish, supposedly. There's white privilege and there's Semite privilege, and they use the guise of Jewish in order to do business in certain industries, especially those concerning finance and entertainment. There's much benefit to this masquerade. Not only did they receive reparations, but they also received all sorts of protections because of the Jewish Defamation League, now called the Anti-Defamation League. Anyone who fixed their mouth to say anything that could be contrived, that could be seen as anti-Jewish, would be ostracized. And not to mention, kept out of important business opportunities simply because they weren't Jewish. This is a good way to hide a Kabbalistic brotherhood and to ensure that everyone who is part of your organization or your industry is under this particular brotherhood's control, under the guise of we're all the same religion. And if you ask and pay attention and listen, most folks who claim to be Jews, European individuals who take on the guise of Jews, only do so for the benefits. They don't even practice the quote-unquote Torah or the quote-unquote laws of it. I'll be glad when the day comes when we can say that his color is not an issue and the color of the biblical Hebrews is not an issue. But until then, the damage that has been done calls for this issue to be dealt with until it is undone. Perhaps I would have, and many who still deny the Gospels would have, accepted him years ago, had the lies about King James, the image of Caesar de Borgia, the color of the biblical Hebrews, and the depiction of the Messiah had not been told. But they were, and we can't ignore it. This generation deserves better. What are dominant genes, and what are recessive genes? Is God a God of order? Or not?
It doesn't sound like I'm whining.
You idiot! I want to know what's going on, and I want to know right now.
Jewish Kabbalist and director Steven Spielberg's concept of you can't change time, as exhibited in his Back to the Future movies, is derived from a concept that he and other Luciferians know very well. You see, those who believe in Lucifer also must and do believe in God. They just don't want to follow him. What Spielberg knew and exemplified in his movies is reflective of what many in the Brotherhood know. No matter what you do, you cannot change what God does. And that's if, and only if, you believe in an almighty God. Avoid doublethink. Think about it. No matter how many times these songs are sampled, the most sampled records ever, the originals are unmistakable still to those with ears to hear. Why don't you think the same is true with scripture, inspired by God? There are various translations of our Bible and even more coming out daily. But don't let that distract you from the fact that all translations are based on the original KJV. Just like there is one, not just Knee Deep by Funkadelic, yet there have been many translations, interpolations, samples, and interpretations. There was still one original from which all copies were made, and that was not inspired by the Holy Spirit. John 15:18-20. If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, then the world would love its own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. You're thinking with a carnal mind about supernatural things again. In a Luciferian controlled world, those who do a great service for the body of Christ will be slandered and defamed. Such a service was done via King James' translation of the Bible from the Hebrew and Greek into English. Dr. Gail Ripplinger, as well as Rebecca Brown, M.D., also did great work for the body of Christ and were attacked for it. Doesn't that make sense? The Brotherhood scholars who spend much time and energy in order to drive you away from believing, and anyone who is effective in helping you believe, especially anyone as influential as a king or a scholarly woman or a doctor, of course, the person's enemies will be brought in to help spread lies and disinformation against them and about them. Have some game about yourself. Don't be so game goofy. Matthew 24:9. Then shall he deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Matthew 10:22. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. And the persecution of Christians as a whole has not yet begun, but those soldiers who have stepped out on the field and done a great work in this war have already received their purple hearts, many of them, and some of them have even lost their lives for it.
Stop whining.
Your kids. Emotions make good slaves but terrible masters. It's energy in motion, emotion, and the emotion that these beings feed off of the most is fear. They can turn anger into fear, which in fact all anger but divine anger is derivative of fear. You become angry because you're fearful of something, fearful because of something that someone has done, or fearful because of some particular outcome that you don't want to see occur, and so you become angry. It's realized that this is a form of fear, and it certainly makes one devoid of comfort. Without comfort, how can you have the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, which will fill you and keep you from being filled up by one of these beings that are always seeking vessels, especially those vessels that are reactive and emotional? So every time we see these shootings of unarmed black men, something that used to occur just as commonly today, if not more commonly, in my father's day, and even in my day, in my 20s, it wasn't broadcast. The news did not pay much attention to these stories. Do you think they're paying attention now because they want you to be informed, or because they want you to be in formation for a war for your very soul, a war that's not only waged with flesh and blood, but a war that they do feed with the blood in the hearts and the minds of those who will turn from comfort and turn from the peace that the Lord brings them, if they would only humble themselves and receive and accept it, and turn toward the ways of the reptile, what they call the reptilian brain thinking, to strike back, to get up and stand up and fight for your rights. Certainly, if your life is threatened or your family is threatened, you have to do what it is that is appropriate for you to do to protect those things. However, you have to understand that the Psalm 2 and 2 Kings are using every tool at their disposal to try to push you out of the comfort of the Comforter and into a state of fear, paranoia, or anger. These are the vibrations that these beings need in order for you to open up your body, call it your chakra or your third eye, or just call it your mind, just like a jar, so they can pour into you these uncomfortable feelings and the spirits that accompany them, and they will tie to you. The more you practice the things that these fallen ones taught the first people on earth, that's why they're the oldest religions. Just because something is older does not mean that it's better for you, as in the case of medicine. Tears, no tears, hoax, staged event. Many will call everything they see fake, but that's dismissive. The agenda is always real. Gun control, race war. Ask yourself why this news is incongruent with news about Bloody Sunday. March, in March, as in march off to war, march when Aries begins, the so-called god of war, spirit or devil of war. Remember, if they publicize and promote a story of a so-called black man, justice and awareness is never the intention. Since the beginning of the rash of shootings of unarmed brothers, the Brotherhood has been trying to get the people riled up for a revolt, especially since the formulation and formation of Black Lives Matter. A politically motivated left-wing, and left-wing or right-wing, same demonic bird, movement, formed by lesbians and financed by Jews, like the civil rights movement was also, and used as agent provocateurs at the top of the pyramid, not the following foot soldiers, but at the top of the pyramid, to help to bring in agendas that are much bigger than you and me. BLM, or adding vowels, blame. Many young don't recognize the markings of controlled opposition or a psyop. They have been trained to be charged and triggered into emo responses. it would do them well to study COINTELPRO and the movements of the 60s and the 70s before allowing Black Twitter and Facebook to shape their political understanding, in my opinion. Just saying. There are some things that get better with time and some things do not. We can gladly say that the way that mankind believed got better with time, in the fact that at the appointed time, the anointed one came on the scene in the flesh. And yes, flesh has a color. There's no coincidence to anything that happens, and the young man that was killed happens to have the name of the first martyr of Christendom, the first recorded martyr of Christendom, Stephen. And although many Black folks don't know what to believe in today, it does not change the fact that there are those who say they are Jews who know exactly who you really are. And they use these signs and symbols Kabbalistically and secretly to speak one to another, to the initiated, and confirm that they are indeed the serpent seed, and they know who you are as well.
Appreciated from my brother was, had you picked up the phone before you went on the air and said, Monique, you've burned too many bridges and there's nothing I can do. See, I would have appreciated had my brother called me up and said, baby, let's talk, because you doing that was a part of me being difficult.
But not before that, though.
Yes, baby.
Remember the moment on stage?
Oh, yes.
See, now that
right
there.
That was a wonderful moment,
Steve. No, it wasn't.
Oh, my goodness.
No, it wasn't.
That was one of those moments.
See, no, it wasn't.
That Richard Pryor whispered in my ear and said, say it. You say it.
Richard Pryor did not tell you to say that.
Yes, he did. Oh, baby, yes, he did. Yes, he did. I do not regret, as I said on the Steve Harvey Show, I do not regret one moment of that night on that stage.
No, in case you don't know, Mo told Tyler Perry.
Uh-huh.
Oprah Winfrey.
Tell him.
And Lee Daniels to suck her private parts.
Not my private parts.
Well, you said if I had one,
yeah,
I want them three to suck my private parts.
Yeah.
It wasn't private parts on stage. So now, then I went, oh, I quit breathing. I quit breathing for you.
I didn't.
What happened to you, Mo,
yes,
was when you made that statement, yes, the narrative got flipped. It wasn't about Netflix no more. It wasn't about Netflix no more. The attention was all off of
that
where we needed
Netflix
to go. Huh?
That was before Netflix.
So good. So now when you bring up Netflix, it doesn't get no win, but you done just said this to these three people. And these three people,
yes,
not because they're powerful, mm-hmm, but because of who they've come. And what happens is, I told you, we can't cure darkness with more darkness. I got
what we
you
can do is cure it with comedy. And what I'm not gonna do, Steve, I'm never ever gonna waver from my comedy show on that stage. That's my gift, and that's my freedom. And what happens is, when you allow people to start taking your freedom and your gift and making it become what makes them comfortable, we then lose. When you called me with the morning show on the phone, I said to you, Steve, my family is suffering behind this. And y'all know I did nothing wrong. Y'all know my husband did nothing wrong. But none of y'all in real time, was strong enough to go publicly and say, we can't throw our sister under the bus.
Because, Mo, listen to me. We fighting two wars here.
What war?
There's two wars. It's what your issue is, and it's what the perception of the issue is, and the narrative has changed.
See, I'm hearing what you're saying, baby, and I agree with it when the narrative changes. But if all of y'all said, this is the only issue I have with it, baby, when all of y'all said privately, to include Oprah, all of y'all said privately, I've done nothing wrong.
When you tell the truth, you have to deal with the repercussions of the truth. We black out here. We can't come out here and do it any kind of way we want to.
Listen to me.
Your husband can't be the Sydney that he really is out here.
Let me tell you something.
That flexing,
we
got to flex a different way. We out here in a game. This the money game. This ain't the black man's game. This ain't the white man's game. This
is the money game.
We in the money game. And you cannot sacrifice yourself. The best thing you can do for poor people is not be one of them. You cannot help them.
We're in the money game. But let me tell you what the game is before the money game. Before the money game, it's called the integrity game. And we've lost the integrity worrying about the money.
But Mo,
wait a minute.
If I crumble,
if you
my children crumble, my grandchildren crumble. I cannot, for the sake of my integrity, stand up here and let everybody that's counting on me crumble so I can make a statement.
Once upon a time, not long ago, there lived a princess named Atalanta.
The serpent seed in their one world order includes one religion and one gender, asexual. Atalanta is derived from Atlantis, as is the new capital of the South, Atlanta. This very Aquarian Age cartoon short was a successful form of programming in the 70s and was used to help indoctrinate children into do as thou wilt thinking in the guise of feminism, as well as in planting the seeds of homosexualism and new age occultism in a cartoon. Pay close attention and you will hear the hidden Atlantean Aquarian agenda made most clear.
Who could run as fast as the wind. She was so bright and so clever, and could build things and fix things so wonderfully that many young men wished to marry her.
What shall I do, said Atalanta's father. So many young men wish to marry my daughter, and I don't know how to choose.
You don't have to choose, father. I will choose. And I'm not sure that I will choose to marry anyone at all.
Of course you will. Everybody gets married. That's what people do.
As for me, I intend to go out and see the world. When I come home, perhaps I will marry. And perhaps I will not.
The king did not like this at all. He was a very ordinary king. Powerful. And used to having his way. So he told Atalanta, I have decided how to choose the young man you will marry. I will hold a great race, and the swiftest young man of all will win the right to marry you.
Now, Atalanta was a clever girl, as well as a swift runner. So she told her father, very well then, let there be a race, but you must let me run in it too. And if I am not the winner, I will accept the wishes of the young man who is. If I am the winner, I will choose for myself what I will do.
The king agreed to this. He would have his way, marry off his daughter, and enjoy a fine day of racing as well. So the king called his messengers together.
Meanwhile, Atalanta herself was preparing for the race. Each night she would go to the field in secret until she could run the course in just 3 minutes. More quickly, she thought, than anyone had ever run it before.
As the day of the race grew near, young men began to crowd into the town. Each was sure he could win the prize, except for one. That was young John, who lived in the town. Each morning, before his studies of the stars and the seas, young John would go to the field in secret and practice running. Day after day, he'd race, fast as the wind, until he could run the course in 3 minutes. More quickly, he thought, than anyone had run it before. At last, the day of the race arrived. The king and his friends sat in soft chairs, and the townspeople stood along the course of the race. The king rose.
Good day,
he said to the crowds.
Good luck,
he said to the young men. To Atalanta, he said, goodbye. I must tell you farewell, for tomorrow you will be married.
I am not so sure of that, Father. Not one of them, she said to herself, can win the race. For I will run as fast as the wind and leave them all behind.
Now a bugle sounded, and the runners were off. At first, they ran as a group.
But Atalanta soon pulled ahead.
With three of the young men close after her. As they neared the halfway point, one of them put on a great burst of speed and seemed to pull ahead for an instant. But then, gasped, and fell back.
Atalanta shot on!
Another young man, tense with effort, drew near to Atalanta. He reached out as though to touch her sleeve, stumbled for an instant, and lost speed.
Atalanta smiled as she ran on. I have almost won, she thought.
Just then another young man neared her. This was young John, running like the wind, as steadily and as swiftly as Atalanta herself.
Atalanta felt his closeness, and in a sudden burst, she dashed ahead.
But young John didn't give up. On he ran, swift as the wind,
until he ran as her equal,
side by side with her,
for the golden ribbon that marked the race's end. Atalanta was aware of him, and she raced even faster to pull ahead.
But young John was a strong match for her.
Smiling with the pleasure of the race,
Atalanta and young John reached the finish line together, and together they broke through the golden ribbon that marked it.
Who is this young man?
I am young John, from the town.
Very well, young John. You have come closer to winning than any man here. And so I give you the prize that was promised.
Thank you, sir. But I could not possibly marry your daughter unless she wished to marry me. I have run this race with a chance to talk with Atalanta.
And I could not possibly marry you before I've gone off to see the world. But I would like nothing better than to spend the afternoon with you. Atalanta told John about her telescopes and her pigeons.
And John told Atalanta about his globes and his geography studies. At the end of the day, they were friends. That same night, John set off by ship to discover new lands.
And Atalanta set off on horseback to visit great cities.
The king stayed home and thought about how the world was changing.
But now Atalanta is still off in the world, visiting towns and cities.
And John is sailing the seas. Perhaps someday they'll be married, and perhaps they will not.
In any case, it is certain they are both living happily ever after.
Natural, biological, and physiological gender roles are being erased. You ever ask yourself, why is it called make-up? As in making up a story. And also making yourself elevated, as in up. Talking about cosmetics. Or the art of cosmetology. Cosmo refers to space. Is there any surprise then that the fallen, who will deceive many into believing they are from outer space, were cast down and taught humans arts of deception, including cosmetology, which is how a lot of people pronounce it, and I believe that that's subconscious and, if you will, Freudian, because it is spelled with an E, as in cosmetics, but we know it's cosmetics as medicine from the cosmos, and the spelling spell vowels interchange. Yet meanings stay related to those with eyes to see the games of the initiated. Now, the young lady pleased him and found favor with him. So he quickly provided her with cosmetics and food, gave her 7 choice maids from the king's palace, and transferred her and her maids to the best place in the harem. Cosmetics were once exclusively the product of a prostitute. Berry juice is the origin for lipstick, when prostitutes would put berry juice on their mouths in order to appear aroused and to arouse men and to make them think of vulgar things. In Esther 2:9 of the KJV, we see that those were things that were thought of for purification among the kings. Proverbs makes it so plain you don't even have to break it down. In 31, verses 30 and 31, favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Women were used to then, and some are used to now, receiving praise based on how well they made up their face and how well they looked in the eyes of man. The prophet Ezekiel also makes it plain in 23 and 40. Verse 40, "And furthermore, that ye have sent for men to come from afar, unto whom a messenger was sent, and lo, they came, for whom thou didst wash thyself, paintest thy eyes, and deckest thyself with ornaments." And do feel free to read these verses for yourself for added context. And I'm certainly not trying to judge, and I don't want to hear everyone's personal story about why they wear makeup or don't. That's up to you. I'm just here to drop off the mail. You can read it or toss it in the trash. In Jeremiah 4:30, it's made plain as Israel is compared to a whore. And the Lord talks about the whoredom of Israel going after other nations, or a whoring after other nations. And this is the analogy that's used. "And when thou art spoiled, what wilt thou do? Though thou clothest thyself with crimson, though thou deckest thee with ornaments of gold, though thou rentest thy face with painting," like you rent a garment, that meant to tear up or to disfigure, because the Father made your face a particular way, and I don't think that you have the artistic skill that he did. "In vain shalt thou make thyself fair. Thy lovers will despise thee. They will seek thy life." The fallen promoted homosexuality, and as part of their punishment for going against the Creator and his creation, they were made asexual and hermaphroditic. The Hindu gods present a great example of that. It is difficult to tell the male from the female deities of India, largely because they are both wearing makeup, or made up, as in not real, a made up story. Men who masquerade as women would not be able to do so without the use of cosmetics. And we've all seen the pharaohs with their famous eye makeup, both the males and the females. The beautification of one's face is nothing but, as we've seen earlier here, the rending or renting of one's face, meaning to mess up, mar, or destroy. But I didn't write the book. I'm just telling you what it say.
All right, welcome back to the end of the world, essentially. Many at the festival cheer Tripathi for reclaiming the lost place in Hinduism for India's third gender. All right, this is what they are rolling out across the world, known as the Hijras, worshipped as demigods for thousands of years. So this person claims to be a demigod. All right, now every ancient culture and every ancient religion has these transvestite pagan priests and sodomites, cult prostitutes, whatever you want to call them. All right, let's look at this concept of a demigod. Demigod, a mythological being with more power than a mortal, but less than a god. A person so outstanding as to seem to approach the divine. In ancient stories, a being who is partly human and partly a god. List of demigods, all right? Greek mythology, all these, the typical names you'd expect to find. Roman, Hindu mythology, all right? Norse mythology, Celtic, other popular fiction. Wonder Woman, hey, look at that. Wonder Woman is a demigod, Diana. Diana, right here in the Bible, Acts 19. Artemis, Diana, same thing. This guy, Demetrius, making silver shrines for Diana. That was his job, right? Big business. Pagan idols, Diana, the goddess of transvestites. The temple of the great goddess Diana, whom all Asia and the world worships. All the world worships Diana. Well, it still does, all right? This is only 2,000 years ago, Paul walking around telling people about the good news. Well, it wasn't good news for these people. They were worshiping Diana, and the whole world was worshiping Diana. The world still worships Diana. The demon goes by many names. Libertas, Statue of Liberty, District of Diana. And when they heard these sayings, they were full of wrath and cried out, saying, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." The city of the Ephesians is a worshiper of the great goddess Diana and the image which fell down from Zeus, all right, Jupiter Zeus. They're worshiping Wonder Woman. 2,000 years ago in Ephesus, and Wonder Woman was the United Nations ambassador for gender equality to achieve their goals by 2030. Wake up, people. Wake up. Daughter of Zeus, Satan, and Hippolyta, queen of the Amazons, twin sister of Apollo.
Identifying with the sex that you were assigned with is called cisgendered, and it's considered a privilege nowadays. So let me make a disclaimer. These are the views and opinions of Transpocalypse Now, which I am in full agreement with during this excerpt, except I have not examined Cortez to define her born gender, nor do I want to. Concerning her, I will only assert that she is a definite vessel being used to push the Atlantis agenda forward.
Okay, now when the gods have twins like this, it often represents an androgynous idea. And they're all basically gender fluid gods, all right? And a lot of legal changes are going to happen coming out of the district of Diana, because Diana is the god of transvestites. All right, I've shown this before in my previous videos. They wish to achieve full gender equality and eliminate gender inequality by 2030. And by gender equality, they mean androgyny. Demigod, Hydra, tradition going back thousands of years. There were sodomites in the land, worshiping their pagan gods. There still are, the district of Diana, a mythological being who is partly divine and partly human, an inferior deity, a deified mortal. Sounds familiar, right? Genesis 6. And look at this picture. They got a picture of a demigod right here, a person who is partly rebellious entity, partly human, demonically possessed transgendered entity. Right here, dictionary.com. A picture of a demigod. Demigod, the cover of the Hollywood Reporter with another demigod. Demonically possessed transgendered entity. TV's 2020 race. Transvestite 2020 race. There's about three or four trannies running for the 2020 election right now. And this one's probably going to jump on board as well, right? Come on. They're basically parading this one around every day in the news. It's a total freak fest. All right, we're in the end times. The fact that this person even exists is evidence that we're in the end times. In fact, it's a Jewish or Canaanite man, Canaanite descent, right? All these people who claim to be of mixed race or whatever it is, they're all Canaanites. They're all a bunch of trannies, all right? Look at those arms, come on. Look at those hands. Look at the skull, all right? You're about to find out the hard way that these are all a bunch of trannies, all right? Documentary filmmaker, no hips, black and white. Look at this, duality, yin and yang, male and female, hand on the hips, brow bone, brow ridge, crossing the arms, right? It's always trying to cover up the body. Look at that thing, man. It's Cortez the killer. They're making a movie about him already, right? Now, whether it's 2020 or 2024, they wouldn't roll this person out with this much media attention if they didn't have plans. No one ever heard of Obama, the Indonesian president we had. And then all of a sudden he's like the Messiah. Same thing going on here. The good news, great voices in heaven saying the kingdoms of this world, the kingdoms of this pagan, evil, corrupt world, all the world worships Diana, are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, the Father and the Son. He shall reign forever and ever. That's the deal. A change of rulership is about to happen after a very short period of incredible violence and death and destruction. And the nations were very angry. Well, of course they were. They're worshiping Diana. When these things start happening, basically, they're going to tell us that we're being invaded by aliens. So all these deceptions we've all been brainwashed with our entire life, they will come into play in the end times. So we're going to see locusts upon the earth. Right? And they're kind of like freaky locusts, but these are God's agents to bring about repentance. When you turn on the news and you see that we're being invaded by aliens, all right? And you may even look outside and see like fire coming down from the heavens or something. So it may not be some kind of special effect like 9/11 was, right? They're going to say that God and his angels are aliens. Two witnesses, fire proceeding out of their mouth and devouring their enemies. Power over waters to turn them to blood, and to smite the earth with all plagues, as often they will. All right. Now, they're going to say that these two witnesses are the bad guys, that these are aliens. And then in the final battle of Armageddon, right, they're going to say, we got to get all the armies of the world together, and we have to fight against the aliens because they're going to come and wipe us all out. Well, it's really God coming to wipe out the evil from the world. So they're going to say that God is an alien invader. And yes, God will be destroying parts of the earth and destroying people. But these are wicked, evil people that did not repent. They chose not to repent. They were warned, but they still chose not to repent. That's what I believe is going to happen. I could be wrong about stuff, right? And I think this will all happen in the next, within the next 10 years or so. Their main weapon is deception. And they're trying to get us to destroy ourselves so that we turn ourselves into abominations, so that we do not enter the kingdom of God. They could kill us all right now if they want, but there's two deaths. The second death is the spiritual death. They don't want us to become like them. We're going to be spiritual beings ourselves and live forever and be at least equal, possibly even higher ranked than them. They don't like that. These angels are supposed to be serving us. They never wanted us to be created to begin with. This is a war of these rebellious angels versus humanity. They've been trying to exterminate us since Genesis 6, days before the flood. They've been trying to turn us into abominations. This person here wants to turn you into an abomination so that you die spiritually, so that you are not resurrected, so that you do not enter the kingdom of heaven. They want to keep you in the kingdom of Satan. This is a priest of Satan, and so is this. It's the same thing. They're all a bunch of hedras, all right? They're transvestite cult prostitutes worshiping the demonic entities. Channeling, in fact, demigod means that they are channeling demonic entities. Look into those black eyes. What's the deal with your black eyes, man? What's going on? Now, the prophecy says clearly that they're going to lose. And I believe that. They don't want you to believe that. They don't want you to believe the Bible. Wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. Destruction, the angel of destruction, the destroyer. Many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leads to life, eternal life. Few there be that find it. Few people.
Oh, come on. Stop whining. You kids are soft.